let's bring up our next guest, good friend of ours, Alec Walt from Down the Block Sports. Alec, it has been a wild, crazy, emphatic type of day. I don't know what word to describe this day in New England Patriots history, but welcome to the show. How's it going, my friend?
I appreciate you guys having me. Yeah, it's been pretty crazy. I woke up to about 3 million text messages from people who, Patriots fans, non-Patriots fans. It was nuts. My phone absolutely exploded. Now, I work till about 4 in the morning, so 10 a.m. when this happened is not exactly when I want to wake up. So, I mean, it was pretty nuts. I had my alarm on a little too loud, and it was ding, 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 ding for like 10 minutes. It was unbelievable, but yeah, I mean, I was not expecting Cam Newton to get released. I mean, I'm not surprised. Bill Belichick's made very surprising moves before in his career, in his role right now. But, you know, you looked at this team right now, it looked like they had the ability to start Cam Newton for the first month or so of the regular season when Cam is known for playing his best. You know, when he takes a couple hits, when his arm strength kind of decreases, you know, you have someone ready to take over in that role if that was to happen. Last year we saw that happen. They had Brian Hoyer, then went back to Cam Newton. Things didn't work out, which is why they had the 15th pick in the draft. And, you know, thank you to the – I always say this all the time. Thank you to the Denver Broncos for trading for Teddy Bridgewater because it completely eliminated them from drafting a QB, which is why Mac Jones fell to 15. But, you know, Mac Jones did a lot to prove that he was, you know, ready for the job. He did great this preseason. So I'm looking forward to it, but yeah, crazy day. I was not expecting to wake up to news that Cam Newton would not be on the team anymore.
Yeah, he was good against us in a few practices too. Kyle and I and James can all account for that. Kyle, yeah. I mean, what do you guys think? I mean, obviously, Alec, you kind of just answered the question, but Kyle, I kind of want your thoughts on this too. Do you attribute Cam Newton's release today strictly and solely to the play of Mac Jones, or was there more to it?
It's so hard to determine. It's because, like Alec has alluded to, Bill Belichick, it all comes at a surprise for us. But at the same time, it's like this was a guy in free agency that was out there for the longest period of time and thought that his NFL career was over at one point in time. And the Patriots, who had him last year, were the team that took a flyer on him, basically, with minimal money, minimal risk. And like Alec alluded to as well, is that bringing this guy back, not knowing if you're going to be able to get a replacement or a quarterback in that 2021 in April in the draft. It was just basically an insurance policy. And like, you know, we saw he played really, really well. And it's just crazy the turnaround from Patriots fans, man. You know, end of April, I can't believe we drafted Mac Jones. And now this is your starting quarterback in a week. It's unbelievable. It's really unbelievable what a couple months can do.
Yeah, I mean, look, Walt, you signed this guy to I believe Newton was due to make $12 million this year on his contract, if I'm not mistaken.
It was up to 12. So he had to earn the 12. I think the 5 was what his salary cap number was, and just incentives, I think, got it up to $12 million or so. But I will have to say this. There were some Patriots fans that weren't very happy Mac Jones got drafted by New England. Let's just clear the air. You guys, that was not me.
No, that was not you. I wasn't talking about you.
I'm just saying, like, I feel like from the beginning, I was one of very few people that has absolutely loved this pick from the start.
I just, what it comes
it makes
down to
so
is
so much sense.
What it comes down to this for what it was for me is that I never hated on the pick because I knew that anybody that Bill Belichick is going to draft at that position, he's going to do well because he's going to make sure. Again, people say, oh, he doesn't fit my system. He's going to make sure that guy fits the system. Look at the grooming in quarterbacks. You know, people jump right to Tom Brady right away. Look at Jimmy Garoppolo. Got him a starting job in the NFL. Jacoby Brissett for a decent amount of time with the Colts, and now he's with Miami. And potentially maybe even he has a chance to fight for that position with Tua, even though they announced that he got the job today. Brian Flores says that's their quarterback. But they drafted Mac Jones. They bulked up the offensive line. They were one of the most COVID-ridden teams last year. That's why I was a little shocked about the Cam situation, is because people don't understand, is that he got COVID last year, combined with the most opt-outs in football, combined with all this COVID-ridden stint. So imagine what he would have done. If you watch those first 2-3 weeks of Cam Newton in a Patriots uniform, that was a really, really good version of a Cam Newton. That's why I was a little shocked that he was released today, especially based on the fact that you would choose Brian Hoyer as your backup over a Cam Newton, who you already knew your system last year. And kind of interesting to see as well, based on the fact that in previous situations, Cam Newton was built around an offense that was dominant in tight end situations. And I thought that's kind of how they built their offseason around, but I guess that just wasn't the case in Arizona.
What do you think about this comment here from Andy Hopper?
He's not wrong. I said those exact words. I mean, realistically, I told him, I said, it's like watching your team have Andy Dalton take the field week one. You know, you're not looking at the future. You are looking at a guy you know is the bridge quarterback. Now, I said before, I have no problem with Cam starting the first month of the season. Even though I was not thrilled that he came back, I didn't have a problem with it. Kyle, you made a great point here. He looked great in the first month of the season. The roster around him this year is way better than it was last year. The Patriots are four deep at running back with guys who can have the balance of running in between the tackles and catching passes. They have a two tight end set, which is probably one of the best in the league, that they spent a ton of money in free agency to get that back into their offense. They paid Nelson Aguilar to have the safeties respect the team over the top. Kendrick Bourne is a possession receiver. You know, they've added a lot of pieces, which is much improved from the team last year. So when you look at Cam Newton, he's a guy who likes to throw the football to the tight ends, has a cannon for an arm if he can hit that deep receiver. A lot of the pieces that Bill Belichick brought into this team made it seem like the move was going to be for Cam Newton. Now, here's what I don't understand about this offseason. If you were intending on moving on from Cam Newton, why did you go an entire preseason without Cam playing any first-team reps? Or Mac playing any first-team reps? So he goes from expecting to be the backup, playing behind Cam Newton, learning how first-team defenses adjust on a week-to-week basis, to then now becoming all the pressure on him to replace Cam Newton, and his two resources this offseason in Brian Hoyer and Cam Newton are no longer on the team. So that makes me a little bit nervous because I don't love that. But let's be real here. He proved that he was closer to Cam Newton than people truly thought. He had the ability to set his feet, scan the field, call plays on the line of scrimmage, just communicate with his wide receivers down the line of scrimmage, have quality meetings with the offensive coordinator on the sidelines, get the ball out of his hands as quickly, find open receivers. There's a lot that you liked out of Mac Jones that you saw in the preseason. So, hey, in Bill I Trust, I think it's going to go over very well, but a little bit surprising that they're putting all this pressure on this kid without even playing any first NFL games. That's what I don't love about it, but I'm completely fine with moving on from Cam Newton because, again, I don't think this team was winning a Super Bowl with him as their QB. I still don't think they are with Cam Newton, but I think he gets you there faster than if Cam Newton was around here in New England.
So with that being said, Cam Newton leaving, what's your expectations for Mac Jones right now? Heading into week one.
I mean, I think the expectation is, you know, I still expect this team to run the ball first. I think it's going to be a run first offense. If they can find a way to kill the clock, play solid defense, run the football, win the time of possession game by 10 to 15 minutes on a game by game basis, I think that's what Bill Belichick's going to want to do. Again, you want to take some of the pressure off the young kid. You have a very solid physical offensive line. You have some power runners with Damian Harris and Ramondre Stevenson. The Patriots have an offense that can benefit from him. Yes, if they do want to pass the ball, you know, Mac Jones has shown that he has the ability to do it. They're going to give him time to scan the field. And he's a guy that gets the ball out of his hands quickly. There's a lot to like between complimenting, you know, the offensive line here and Mac Jones. Now, one thing I also like, he has two security blankets. Pick one when you get to the red zone, because if you double one, the other's going to be open. Plus, you do have some other solid wide receivers who can get open as well. So my expectation is him to have a very solid rookie year. I mean, the offensive pieces aren't amazing. I don't think he's going to throw for 4,500 yards and 50 touchdowns in his rookie season. Let's be real here. He doesn't have the Tennessee Titans offensive skill pieces around him. It's Jacoby Myers, Nelson Aguilar, Kendrick Bourne, and N'Keal Harry if he ends up making the team. But You know, I expect him to limit the turnovers. I expect him to put some points up on the board. But at the end of the day, it'll be a run-first offense to do whatever they can to take some of the pressure off him on his season. By I do think he'll get, you know, roughly 3,500 or so yards. I don't think the passing game is going to completely disappear. You have to put points up on the board, especially when you play teams like the Bucks, Cowboys, Bills twice, and teams like that. But get ready for the Patriots to run the ball a ton. I think that was the plan with Cam Newton, and that will still be the plan when Mac Jones here at quarterback.
All right, James, thank you for that. I know you're going to hop behind the scenes again for a minute. You'll be back later. So, James, we'll see you in a little bit. Thank you very much. Now, Walt, I want to ask you this next question about the Sony Michel trade with the Rams. The Patriots acquired a 2022 sixth-round pick and a 2023 fourth-round pick in return. Now, New England with all these running backs, Damian Harris, James White, what are your thoughts on this Sony Michel trade?
I had a feeling he was kind of the odd man out. He was the first-round pick that really didn't live up to expectations. I know there was question a lot about that fifth-year option. You looked at the Patriots. They were pretty young and had some, you know, controllable pieces there at running back. It just didn't look like Sony Michel was going to be part of the question. Obviously, the number one running back was going to be Damian Harris, followed by James White. They drafted Ramondre Stevenson. They were bringing back J.J. Taylor. They have plenty of options. Now, I'm happy they were able to get some return on it because running back's a position that doesn't have amazing trade value. There's millions of them. You know, that's a position where teams are not afraid to go with as many running backs just to get through a 17-game regular season. There's not as many, you know, McCaffreys, Henrys, Cooks like that around the NFL. And you looked at the Rams. You know, they were dealing with injuries to Darnell Henderson. They were looking at potential breakout seasons from guys like Xavier Jones. It really wasn't pretty for the Rams at that running back position. So the Patriots found a trade partner, were able to move on from that contract, get at least something in return. I mean, if you're a sixth and a fourth round pick for someone who was a first round selection, you obviously didn't do very well with the pick overall. I think Sony Michel for New England fans was a bust. You know, we expected him to be a true number one running back. He came to New England and did not do that. So at the end of the day, you know, you got something in return, but you know, I'm not too worried about running back here in New England. They're four deep and it's going to be one of their stronger positions here on the offensive side of the football.
Yeah, Alec, I completely agree 100%. And it's just based on the fact, you know, when they drafted Sony Michel, because we've obviously seen these first 3 years of his career, he wasn't a running back that did, you know, there wasn't a sticking point where he's like, he's really good at that. And on top of the fact, with the Patriots drafting a running back with a first-round selection, based on the fact that if you watched any Patriots football over the course of the last decade plus, they really haven't ever had a solidified number one. I mean, even these last couple seasons, it's like a new game plan every week of who Bill Belichick wants to have run the football. I can't even tell you how many times last season, I know they dealt with a lot of COVID stuff and a lot of injuries, where it was literally a different running back every single week. You'd have Rex Burkhead blow up 1 week. You'd have Bolden blow up 1 week. You've had James White have a great week. They never had any consistency. And like you said, for a guy in Sony Michel was a former first-round pick to not pan out, really means he wasn't that great. But in terms of the offensive weaponry, because we talked about the skill position players, we talked about how obviously they're not Tennessee Titans skill position players, but they invested a lot of money in that. And while they might be a little run-dependent, who do you think will lead this team in terms of touchdown catches? Who will be, I guess you could say, Mac Jones's favorite target, essentially?
I find it hard to believe it's not Jonnu Smith. I mean, especially with the injury to Hunter Henry here in the training camp, it allowed Jonnu to really take over as the number one tight end in practice. And the guy can jump out the gym. He's a massive target, huge hand. You can basically lob it up to him and it's game over unless you're triple teaming him with someone standing on his shoulders. I mean, this kid's an absolute animal. I really think it'll be an even split. I mean, I know fantasy people are always like, don't draft, you know, New England's tight ends because you never know which one of the two of them is going to lead the team in touchdowns. But, you know, from a receiving standpoint, I find it hard to believe it won't be Jonnu. I think Hunter Henry will be a close second, but I expect those two tight ends to see a lot of action inside 20 yards.
I'd agree with that. I think the tight end is a good position to pick because I really don't like what New England has at wide receiver, if I'm being honest. Jacoby Myers is a decent guy, but N'Keal Harry hasn't really panned out. And then Nelson Agholor, Kendrick Bourne could potentially be a guy, but you're right. I'm going to agree with you and say Jonnu Smith. Now, my next question is Stephon Gilmore, obviously on the PUP list out until at least week 7. Who do you think will step up in Stephon Gilmore's absence?
Well, they're going to have to really rely on J.C. Jackson. He's someone who stepped up in a true number two role, had outstanding corner numbers. I know a lot of people said it had to do with him facing, you know, number two receivers with Gilmore, you know, shadowing the number ones. But you got to think he's really going to step up in that role. They also have Jonathan Jones, who's been a surprise. They signed Jalen Mills from the Philadelphia Eagles. They also acquired the rookie at from Ohio State, Sean Wade from the Baltimore Ravens. So the Patriots have great depth at the cornerback position, even though Stephon Gilmore is not there. I think there's a lot of pressure on Jackson and Mills because I do expect Wade to more likely than not be the slot cornerback. Obviously, you got to look at McCourty, who's going to be playing that free safety position pretty much all season. So the Patriots, one strength they do have defensively is they might have the deepest secondary in all of football. I mean, when Stephon Gilmore comes back, they're going to have five guys who can cover. And the matchups they can provide, I mean, we'll see how Bill Belichick pans all of this out. But the fact that they're losing one of the best cornerbacks in football and have four other options who are respectable and can cover guys around this league is pretty outstanding. I think Belichick's done a fantastic job building his secondary here. Because, I mean, yes, it sucks that Gilmore isn't there, but I'm not terrified of teams torching this secondary without him on the back end.
Now, like we just talked about the secondary, obviously, and with that comes the defense as a whole. And Tom and I were on the phone this morning. We were just talking about the Patriots as a whole as soon as the Cam Newton cut happened. But just in terms of the outlook of this team and where they could potentially rank themselves, I think the defense is, to be honest with you, criminally underrated. You know, you don't hear anybody talking about how great this defense really can be just based on one offseason. You brought in Godchuck. You drafted Christian Barmore, who I think was one of the steals of the draft. And granted, you are missing Stephon Gilmore, but essentially we'll get him back midway through the season. And like you said, already have a lethal and really, really deep secondary upon other guys bringing back a Kyle Van Noy, who was terrific when in a Patriots uniform. So, and Dont'a Hightower, the list goes on and on. It's just, This is a defense that's not being talked about. When personally, I feel this can be, you know, when all is said and done, when the 2021-2022 season is over, they could finish off as like a top five, top seven defense in football.
Yeah, I mean, one of the big question marks going into free agency was finding a respectable member of the front seven. Not saying that these guys aren't, you know, unbelievable, but they needed to get that guy. You know, they had, you know, a Chase Winovich, a Lawrence Guy, they brought back Kyle Van Noy. They had really solid pieces that could, you know, fill one of the gaps, but they needed an absolute game changer. It is absolutely insulting how underrated this Matthew Judon pickup is. Yeah. I don't think it's almost like people forgot that Belichick spent millions of dollars to get him off the edge. I mean, the difference this guy is going to make on this defense is absolutely unbelievable. He can rush the quarterback. He's strong on the run. He can run towards the sidelines. He's the focal point of this defense. He's going to set up everyone else on the other side because, you know, when you look at the Patriots defensive line, they have other guys that can get to the quarterback. I mean, Dietrich Wise, what's his name? Chase Winovich, Josh Uche has really stepped up, and having a presence like Judon in this front seven is going to set them up very well on the other side. Also, you mentioned before Christian Barmore, who had coaching problems. I mean, I didn't really hear anything about that until the day before the draft. So if Belichick had something to do with that, good for you, because you got a steal there in the second round. But with Hightower coming back, Van Noy coming back, while also getting the draft pick compensation for him signing for more than $40 million with the Dolphins, thank you very much. This defensive depth is absolutely unbelievable. And adding Judon is absolutely going to change the way this team plays defense. I mean, I know it's the preseason. You still got to see a little bit more. He may not have been playing the number one left tackle every single series, but he made an impact every single snap. I mean, you saw him for one possession, and you knew he was there. I think Belichick's going to have a field day with this guy rushing the passer this year.
That's definitely a great point. Now, speaking of Bill Belichick, how much longer of a window do you think he has left as the head coach? I believe he's the oldest coach in the league, if I'm not mistaken. He's 69 years old, so he's pretty up there in age. What are you thinking? How many years do you think he has left?
I was surprised that he decided to stick around for the development of another quarterback. You know, it seemed like he was really set on Jimmy Garoppolo. Obviously, Tom Brady decided he was going to continue playing late into his 40s. Next thing you know, they move on from Garoppolo, keep Tom Brady. And as Brady leaves, Belichick still sticks around. I mean, I still think he has a couple years left of coaching in him. He's absolutely addicted to it. He is the best to ever do it. He has a young, promising QB right now with Mac Jones. He has a great coaching staff. He has a great job. He's still in a great organization. There's a lot to like with this Patriots team. Now, you know, I think maybe I wouldn't be surprised if he left anytime within the next like 5-6 years. I could see this guy sticking around. Where's he going to go? There's been no reports of him wanting to leave, being interested in leaving. Then again, who the heck's going to know? Because he doesn't really release any information. But I don't see him slowing down. I just, he's a guy that is addicted to football 24/7. I just can't see him not being in football. It's just the type of guy that he is. So, hey, I mean, I'll keep him in New England as long as he'd like to, but I think he's got a couple more years in him. I think he's retiring later than sooner.
Now, Kyle and I, we're going to talk to you about our surprise cut of the day. But first, Walt, was there anybody that stuck out to you as a surprise cut outside of Cam Newton, just to be clear?
Not really. I mean, Brian Hoyer, I believe, also got cut. So they're going to have to find a way to bring in another quarterback. I'm interested to see what direction Bill Belichick goes with there. Again, it's a little surprising that both of Mac's other quarterback resources are not going to be there at the start of the season. So hopefully Bill can bring in a solid backup QB for Mac Jones. Other than that, I mean, nothing really blew me away. I mean, a lot of the big names on this team remain. Maybe some surprise cuts come later, but really the only surprises to me were the fact that he cut two quarterbacks, and hopefully he brings in one very soon.
Yeah, I would have to agree as well. When we talk about surprise cuts, I mean, this was the cut of the day. This was mind-boggling. So I don't really – maybe an Adrian Colbert. I think maybe that was a little bit of a surprise. I know they had a deep secondary. I know he's kind of in the shuffle in the safety class. But that's really about it, maybe. I can't really think of anybody off the top of my head that was really a surprise cut outside of, you know, Cam Newton. And then again, Brian Hoyer as well, just the fact that he cut two quarterbacks.
I'm in full alignment. Don't mean to be a little repetitive with that, but I was going to say Brian Hoyer only because the two quarterback situation, but congrats on Quinn Nordin. I think he's a decent young talent who could be something in this league, beating out Nick Folk for a roster spot. Nick Folk has been in the league for forever, it seems. Yeah. I remember when he was a Cowboy back in like grade school, but yeah, he's definitely my player. Are there any impact players to watch for New England this year? We talked about Jonnu Smith. We talked about Mac Jones. Anybody else in particular that, you know, your average fan on the outside looking in may not know too much about?
The average fan may know this guy's name at this point, but I think it's very clear that Damian Harris is the number one running back here in New England. Yes, I expect them to use running back by committee, but, you know, Ramondre Stevenson had an excellent preseason, but I do still think the backfield is Harris's. So, you know, we'll go with this Alabama duo back there, which is really solid. We mentioned this name before. I'm a huge fan of Kendrick Bourne. I think he has a chance to really step up and be a productive wide receiver. Again, he's a possession guy, so I think Mac's going to find him a ton. Other than that, I mean, defensively, I think a guy to definitely watch out for is Josh Uche. He's someone who looked pretty productive in his couple snaps there in the preseason. I like Jalen Mills. I thought he was a solid pickup. I think J.C. Jackson's going to make some noise here as number one cornerback for a couple weeks, so the Patriots have a couple guys, but I think because of how important it's going to be offensively for a few skill pieces, I do think Harris and Bourne are going to be two very productive pieces here in the offense. A lot of people aren't talking about.
I think when I look at this team, you know, we can go to the skill players, we can go to the defensive side of the ball, but the offensive line specifically, that's what it comes down to for me. The reacquisition of Trent Brown, that is – it was the first move, but it happened so long ago that people forget about it. That's going to be Mac Jones's best friend, on top of the fact that's only going to further help improve this run game, which we saw last year between the run game and the quarterback protection was awful. And then you have another guy, too, We see all this offensive lineman drafted last year. Everybody knows the core four of Jedrick Wills, Andrew Thomas, Tristan Wirfs, and escaping me right now. Becton. Escaping me. Who?
Becton.
Mekhi, how do you forget him? Mekhi Becton with the Jets. But Michael Owenu. Michael Owenu was one of the best offensive linemen drafted last year.
And he never had a position.
Exactly. So this offensive line as a whole is going to furthermore improve and really show really almost a perfect situation coming from a guy that was judged in Alabama for getting the most perfect of protection to going with New England to getting really, really, really good protection as well.
You know, I had an interview a while back with Nick Fitzy Stevens from WEEI Sports Radio. It was back on like my fourth episode or so of the Alec Wald Show. And it was right around when they acquired or reacquired Trent Brown from the Vegas Raiders, which I'm still getting used to saying. I still can't get Vegas and Oakland. I still mix that up all the time. And he said, Trent Brown blocks two things, people and the sun. He's the biggest lineman, it seems like, in football. I mean, it was an unbelievable addition. And, you know, you made a great point. The offensive line fits the identity of this Patriots team absolutely perfectly. They're going to be run first, smash mouth, you know, kill the clock, grind out some of these wins. And when you look at their backfield, guys like Stevenson and Harris can do that. Want to give a different look. They have one of the better pass-catching running backs. He's been doing it for years here in New England. With James White, you know, I think Bill Belichick has a game plan. He has the pieces that fit that game plan. And adding a big, mean offensive line, adding pieces like Trent Brown, Shaq Mason's been doing it for years. Move on Wenyu to the inside. Also, Andrews, hopefully Wynn can stay healthy. You know, you better have some bodies there on the defensive line because this team is going to come ready to pound you here on the interior.
Sorry, I was muted. I'm going to go with Dante Hightower only because he opted out last year, and I think New England missed him a lot defensively. I think he's going to be a tackling machine for you guys, so I'm going to go with him. And I think, you know, again, he's still somewhat of a relatively younger player. You know, he's not considered an old player, and I think he's a guy that could potentially make some noise this season, be potentially among the league-leading tacklers as well. And at this time, quickly – record prediction, team MVP. You go first, Walt.
I think this team has the chance to get close to 10 wins because their schedule isn't impossible. When I look at games that I think that they pretty much don't really have a chance in is Buccaneers, you know, Titans, Bills twice. I mean, it's a very reasonable schedule. I mean, they play the Dolphins twice, I think the Dolphins will be better. Play the Jets twice. I think the Jets suck. The Saints without Michael Thomas. I think Dallas will be an improved team with Dak Prescott back. You know, the Texans suck. The Chargers have no clue how to beat Bill Belichick. Panthers are the most underrated team in football. Browns will probably beat them. Falcons suck. Colts, who's playing quarterback? Jags, I think they'll be interesting. It's a very winnable schedule. There's a lot of 50-50 games. And with Bill Belichick as your head coach, you think you're going to win a majority of those. So I'm going to say safely 9-8. But I think this team has a very legitimate chance to get to those 10 wins with Mac Jones here as a starting QB. I thought they had a very solid chance if Cam was able to win, you know, three or four games out of the first month, then, you know, kind of do the passing of the torch. But, you know, I trust that Bill Belichick made the right decision. He's been making very good decisions throughout his entire NFL career, and you got to hope he's able to do it here. But I think 9 wins would be a floor, but I think this team has a very solid chance to get to that 10, 11 win mark and make some real noise here. Because I'm really not that scared of their schedule, but there are some teams in there that are going to give them a hell of a game.
For me, when I look at this team, I see 11-6. I don't think it's enough to win the division, but that's what I see. You know, I'm looking at the first 7 weeks of the season alone. I think they could go 6-1 within the first 7 weeks. I think that Tampa's a loss. A team like New Orleans, team that's up in the air, the Jets twice, Miami, again, big question mark. What are we going to get out of Tua Tagovailoa? We really don't know. Now it's his team, essentially. Even the Dallas Cowboys, while the offense is lethal and while we think that it's slated to be so, question marks with Dak Prescott and the defense, again, we don't know what we're getting. So I think that this is a team that could win a lot of games really early and get on a hot streak. And with that winning momentum, I think it only puts him in a great position further down the line of the season to eclipse that double-digit win mark at 11-6.
They have a schedule to do it. Again, I think their floor is 9 wins. That's if, like, there's a blocked field goal or some dumb nonsense that happens in the NFL. But I think this team has a very legitimate chance to get into that double-digit mark.
Yeah, I'm also going 11-6. And I think the decision today gave me a couple of extra wins for them. I think starting Mac Jones week one will benefit them. And I do want both of your team MVPs quickly. My team MVP for New England, it's going to be Dante Hightower. He's going to be the captain, the leader of that defense, in my opinion. So what do you guys think?
Have fun blocking Matthew Judon. I think he is going to have a disgusting, absolutely disgusting season here in New England. I think their front seven went from one of the least exciting in football to one of the most underrated, in my opinion. I think with the addition of your guy, Dante Hightower, my guy here, Matthew Judon, Belichick's going to know how to use this guy absolutely perfectly. You're going to have to respect him on every single play. He made some major noise here in the preseason. I think that noise continues into the regular season. I think this guy is going to absolutely own it here in New England in his first season.
I'm going to go with Mac Jones. You know, Bill Belichick just chose to start this. Bill Belichick chose to start this guy, but you look at everything we just talked about, from the defensive side of the ball to the offensive line to the skills position players. He is in a position to succeed. It's just a matter of him showing up. And just looking at his college career, the guy does not know how to lose. And right now, as far as I'm concerned, he's not in a losing situation. And I think as long as he performs, he's going to lead this team to that record that we just talked about and potentially the playoffs.
Yep. All right, so we all have our team.
Mac Jones would have the most wins of the rookie QBs potentially in his first season.
he is in the best situation.
Matters.
Yeah. So we all picked our team MVPs. All right, one last question: who wins the AFC East? I'm going Buffalo.
Unless Mac Jones turns into Aaron Rodgers, it's Buffalo.
Yeah, it's just Buffalo. I have Buffalo. I'd say Buffalo wins 13. I had Pats at 11. So, but I think it's tight. I do think.
Ooh,
it's
where do you have the Dolphins in that case?
I don't know, man. I don't know how much stock I can invest in. It's very hard for Tua.
I like Flores.
Yeah.
Which makes
me. Of course, you like Flores.
No, I'm just saying, like, minus the Patriots fact, I think he individually wins them games.
I think his defensive
game planning.
That's what I'm saying. I think the defense keeps them in a lot of games, like we saw last year, between the combination of Xavier Howard and Byron Jones and then everything up front. But the offense, I think, again, is still a question mark. And with Tua, you know, even now being a question mark, the fact that it wasn't even a guarantee, that forget about that he was going to be the starting quarterback on this team, but that he was going to be the quarterback for this team in general up until maybe a couple weeks ago, is really how much faith they're showing me in him. So I think I have them as the third place team in this division.
All right, Walt, we'll just ignore that comment from James. why don't you tell the listeners where people can find Down the Block Sports, your podcast?
So you can find Down the Block Sports on YouTube. We are YouTube only, so if you want to check out our content, it's going to be live on Down the Block Sports. Feel free to give us a sub. We're nearing about 440 subscribers, so thank you to all who are listening who have subscribed. If you have not yet, please do so. Again, Down the Block Sports. I posted 2 videos today, one about Cam Newton, another about the Baltimore Ravens. I had Alfonso DeFalco join me for a show, so if you want to check out those 2 episodes, they are the 2 latest episodes on the channel. I also have interviews with Dan Grasso, pre and post of the Jets, Lance Meadow, pre and post of the Giants. I have Scott Jackson coming on Thursday. He is the pre and post of the Washington football team. Kevin Fitzmorris is also joining me later this week to talk some New England Patriots. My guest lineup is absolutely loaded, so you guys are going to want to check it out. Down the Block Sports on YouTube. That's where you'll find me and all of my videos. Please give me a sub if you have not yet.
Alec, thank you so much for joining tonight. Really do appreciate it. Best of luck to your New England Patriots heading into 2021. And Mac Jones, got to keep up with Jones.
Yeah. Hey, thank you very much, guys. I really appreciate you having me. I've been excited about Mac Jones since day one. I was not expecting him to start on day one, but it's an exciting time to be a New England Patriots fan. We are officially on to a new era. I'm looking forward to seeing what Mac Jones can do this season.
Thanks, Walt. Appreciate it.
Peace out, boys.
See you, man.